I hope everyone had a great lunch. We are ready to resume.
Just for the record.
I was going to say, too bad you get a picture of it, you get it forwarded to me, and I'll post it on
here. Our next presentation will be from People, Inc. Talk some of their efforts to transition people from work, from dayhab services to employment. They'll be focusing some of the innovative things they've been doing in the area of staff training, in the area of transportation, and also some of the work that, they're doing to transition students from high school to employment. Blink.
Good afternoon. I'm Bill Schultz. I oversee day services and employment services within People Incorporated. It's a Western New York agency. To be very brief, we started our first developmental center services in 1975 and transitioned to day treatment services in 1979. We grew from there. We moved into group dayhab funding in the mid-90s and today, and I apologize, I skipped right over. I'd also like to formally Jim Scott, who is a director of our employment transition and vocational services within People Incorporated, and he's been instrumental in moving all of our group dayhab services into the world of work over the last 5 years. Saying all that, again, People Incorporated is located in Western New York. We have 26 group dayhab locations. They're made up of some of your more traditional group dayhab programs, and we also have 11 community-based smaller group dayhab programs. Five are located on local college campuses. They're time-limited for individuals, and that helps get them started from after the high school years prepping them for employment in addition to the life skills activities they're involved in on campus. We also have four small community-based programs that are located out in the community, which its focus has always been to help people, in addition to the life skills instruction, moving them into the world of work also. Within those programs, many people are going part-time in group day, is receiving life skills, and also co-enrolled in supported employment services.
And one of the reasons we're giving this program overview is just so people understand what we've learned is, I'm a supported employment guy, and I always have, just as Stacy was mentioning, I need to understand what's happening within our dayhabs and the pure vastness of our dayhabs, and sort of prioritizing and figuring out who within there and what tools do we have in supported employment that can make them be successful. So our next slide is I think kind of sets the framework for the next few minutes we're going to have. Is the strategies that not just our supported employment programs utilize, but all of our programs within People Inc., whether it be residential or our business office or our human resources office. We all need to buy into this philosophy of employment for everyone. And so one of the ways we do that, obviously, is innovation and employment support training. And we started out sending a lot of our supported employment staff, only to find out that it's really our dayhab staff that need to be there, that need to get the message and to understand the philosophy behind that. There's also a job readiness curriculum that's used in different stages and various day programs. Bill had alluded to some of the smaller community-based dayhabs, our CAP programs, our YELP programs. One of the important things we figured out about 5 years ago is they need assembly liaison. They need someone from our program to help educate their families and the people within their program. Because a lot of things that could come up are safeguards and what do we need to do now so that when they leave those programs in a couple of years, they're better prepared. The fourth strategy we utilize is, you know, that whole idea they could never work, which I got to be honest, I was guilty of a few years ago. I'd meet someone and I'd be, you know, they could never go to work. But instead of that, what's it going to take for them to get to work? And one of the ways we've done that internally is a work group that meets on a monthly basis. Some of the leaders and some of the instructors from our dayhabs, we need that good cross-section. People from our business office so that they understand as we're trying to start new businesses and develop revenue streams independent of Medicaid or Access VR. They need to be on board and understand that. Our human resource department needs to understand when we're putting in these requisitions for positions, why we are. And it's really neat to see the different perspectives and ideas that are generated from that. It's been a really kind of neat thing. We're going to talk about some of the, I don't want to say programs, but services slash businesses that have come out of that group. And then last but not least is everyone's definition of employment is different. We had an individual, when we asked him what does being employed mean, for him, he wanted to make $32.50 a week. And we figured, okay, that's a good starting point, So let's let's start there and go from there. But through discovery, really kind of figure out what it means for that individual, for that person, what employment is. I know what employment is. I'm a supported employment guy, but, that definition sort of varies. And then develop a strategy around that discovery process, understanding that work's not a reality next month or in a few months, but, what are we doing 3, 4, 5 years down the road to make sure that they can become successfully employed. Briefly, we're going to go through 3 or 4 or 5 either funding streams or programs that have allowed us to do some of this stuff. And then the neat stuff really comes at the end. It's some of the affirmative businesses we've developed so that our agency can be a leader in hiring our folks. We're going to go out in the community and ask other businesses to. We really need to make that commitment ourselves. So.
Again, to be very brief, our LIGHT program is a very small program. It's helping individuals start their own businesses. We currently are working very actively with 8 individuals. We have a couple more individuals who are just going through the individual services and supports, consolidated services and supports, and that's basically where the funding for this particular program, helping individuals start their own small businesses. We have one individual who's doing her own house cleaning. We've helped her with marketing, linked her up with some college resources. We've helped get her to the point where she's very independently able to go into senior centers and put up advertisements. When she started that business, she was working part-time in a grocery store and part-time, and she's at this point moved away from working for someone else. She is truly self-employed. Her family is very involved, very supportive, and it's very successful. In addition, we're helping one gentleman. He's got right now 25 snack machines that he's putting out in the community, and he's earning revenue from all of those machines. We're helping, happens to be an individual who's a Native American, and that individual is developing He creates Native American art, and we'll be selling that. Beyond that, I think we'll just keep moving since we only have.
Yeah, and this is one of the products of two entrepreneurs together. One makes the T-shirts, and the other one designs them. So it's kind of a neat idea. I can speak out against bullying. We do a lot of different designs for various businesses. Another tool we utilize is ETP. I'm not going to spend any time on that. If you don't know what it is, you really need to find out what it is. It's a really awesome tool, particularly for a lot of our guys. I heard earlier the question came up, what if Access VR says no and ESEMP says no? I thought of ETP right away, but there's a lot of other resources. We have a Museum of Disability History, which is one of a kind for every month. We'll do a quick advertisement for it. It's a really awesome museum. And the tours are done by docents, individuals who have disabilities themselves provide the tours. So they're employees of People Inc. and they're paid commensurate with what a docent within the agency does. And then our cleaning crews, I know there's lots of cleaning crews, lots of enclaves. What we've been able to do is structure those in a way that's providing an extra revenue stream so we can employ people who maybe don't fit the Access VR mold, the ESEP mold, or the ETP mold. The revenue provided through that can support them without having to put them in one of those 3 or 4 or 5 traditional employment programs. And then there's our PIVOT, our vending program.
That's another program that we've had in operation for about 7 years right now. It employs 18 individuals. They have a employment specialist that goes out, generally 2 individuals. They have a fixed route, of vending machines, pop machines, snack machines, and their wages come from the profits from the sale of items. We hope through some other new initiatives that we're going to be able to help grow that program in the near future.
And we'll talk about that in a minute. And then ESEMP, you all know what that is. The Way to Work program is a really neat program. We secured private foundation money through the Walmart State Giving Project. We have a lot of people in our day hubs who are interested in culinary arts. And one of the things was, how we're restructuring those volunteer opportunities, kind of like what Stacey was talking about earlier. So we developed a collaboration with another local provider agency who has two certified kitchens who provide catering and other services to the community at large. So we work together with them to get people in and get them hands-on work experience, but it mirrors a work environment. And while they're there, if they don't have a job coach, it's our job to get them a job coach through whatever program is most suitable and accept them, but that they'd be eligible for. We're in the infancy. We just had a group who, quote-unquote, graduated. There are four of them. Two of them are working. Three got a job offer. And hopefully the fourth person kind of needs a little bit extra time, so we're going to put them in another 12-week thing. But so, and the people we're really emphasizing in this are those who don't already have a job coach, those who don't currently receive any of the real other services, but we need to get them a job coach, and we need to get them a job. Bill had mentioned the many.
And they were in group day-hab services during this COVID.
And some of them may still be, but most of them are have some sort of combination of the both. So that's a really cool thing. And then the mini vending, Bill.
Again, trying to introduce the world to work for a lot of individuals who have been receiving group day-hab services for long periods of time. We were beginning to identify individuals from the staff that work directly with them day in and day out that they've talked about wanting to work, but they've never had that opportunity. And we also have some individuals who 20 years ago, 30 years ago, may have worked in a work center, but it didn't work out, and they ended up in a group day-hab program. So we've begun identifying those individuals, and because of our experience with our vending operation, we take a look at the vending machines in that particular site, and we will clock them out of their day service program. We get staff to volunteer to work one-on-one with them after they've been trained by our vending support employment staff, and that individual, for only a couple hours a week, as a starting point, an introduction to the world of work, they become a part-time employee of People Incorporated. They get the prevailing, the $7.55 or $7.85 an hour for the time that they're actually cleaning the snack machines, washing and maintaining those machines. And that's just the first step. But the point I think we've been trying to make within all of our agency programs, look at each individual and figuring out, on an individual basis, what can we do to bring the world of work to an individual who's asking for that opportunity.
Yeah, and we talked earlier. Now, we're an agency. We've never had pre-book, and we've never had workshop services. So some of the things that came out of development out of this work group may sound familiar, but they're structured around what Bill had mentioned, what they're doing in their day abs. So if they're cooking in their day abs, or they're making wood art, wood pens, if they're cleaning the vans, how do we now get them paid to do that stuff? And so these are some of the programs that are either in development or have started, where we're collecting a revenue stream in order to pay these individuals to do the stuff they've always done within the day abs, but now they got to be held accountable and there's expectations associated with it. But as a bonus, they're getting paid, and sometimes they're getting supported through supported employment, or they're just getting supports through staff who work within that business. And so these were some of them: the food service, the catering, custom wood art. I mean, that guy who said he wanted to make $32.50 an hour, he made pens and bowls and stuff, so it was up to us to figure out how to do that. And then just, we highlighted throughout the agency and throughout the public, the people Inc., we have a farm now, and it's stuff people have always loved to do, so now it's up to us to try.
We have a farm program.
But it's on a farm. I call it a farm. The other thing is, we're a compass agency, so we like to highlight some of the stuff we do, recipe for success, how it relates to that. And I really, don't want to take up more time, but a lot of the activities we've structured in the community through those traditional group day app are activities designed around employment and leadership. So, you know, whether it be the local chamber of commerce, for the various, you know, entrepreneurial spirits of those folks. And so that's it in a nutshell. I mean, I could talk about this for the next 3 hours. I'm certainly not going to do that. So thank you guys for your time.
So we're going to have these come up next, and as that PowerPoint is being prepared, I just want to highlight a couple of things that came out in the People Inc. presentation. And again, another example of pre-employment happening and the other thing that was kind of glanced over is that in this particular example, People Inc. created some of their own businesses and are hiring people onto their staff. But what's important to note that there is a distinction between when people are working and when people are day hab. I want to be really, really clear and not make that fuzzy, that people are not in day hab working and getting paid. In day hab, they're doing pre-employment, developing skills, and Bill referred to clocking people in and out. That was the whole, they're no longer in day hab anymore, because I don't want anyone to be confused and said that Solon said it's okay to pay people in day hab. No, that's not what you heard. for the record, yes. But again, another innovative strategy. So we're going to hear from Katrina from Capabilities, and she's going to talk about what they're doing with their community-based pre-vote program.
Thank you. I'm Katrina Stan from Capabilities down in the southern tier of New York, down in Elmira, and our organization is strictly a vocational organization. So we don't do any day hab, we don't do any residential, we do only employment, and we've only done employment for the last 55 years. Or more than 55 years, I guess. I'm terrible at math. So I was asked to talk a little bit about our pre-vote service. After some conversations with Pat Douse from NYSRA and some of the neat things that we've been doing. So we are an employment agency, but we only started offering pre-vocational services in 2009. I'm not really sure how we missed the boat on that. We started as a sheltered workshop, and still, you know, that still exists in a new form, but we never jumped on the pre-vocational services bandwagon, and it wasn't until 2009 actually, OPWDD came to us and said, all this, you know, local assistance, state-funded stuff has got to change. You got to change to adding the pre-vocational services. And what we've done, really, honestly, it's very simple stuff. We haven't done anything that we feel is anything really complex. It's just really natural extensions of ways of doing business. So we started in 2009, and we are very small in what we converted. I think we had 12 people in 2009 in our pre-vocational services. So it was a small group, and it still is a small group. Some things we knew. We knew that facility-based services were not going to carry us into the future when we converted in 2009. And how did we know this? We have a leadership with a great vision that knew that this was going to become a thing of the past very quickly. We also had a strategic plan that really focused on community-based services. And we also had experience working with the Model Transition Program, which was a program that Access VR brilliantly put out there a number of years ago and then quickly took it away because it was so successful. sorry. And what we learned from working with the youth in the Model Transition Program is, and when we would bring them into our facility, is they didn't identify with this facility-based service. They didn't identify with sitting in a group with other people. Like, they just didn't identify. These kids came in and they said, I want to work at Wegmans. I want to work at Walmart. I want a real job. I am not coming into your program. The other experiences we had a successful ops program. We have a blended ops that's pre-vocational supported employment. And so our success in that kind of led us into this being more community-based with our pre-vocational. We also have our business operations. So we operate a number of businesses within our agency, and they're community-based as well as facility-based businesses. And those, by having those business operations that we set staff, that we supervise, allowed for a really safe experience for that risk that we were talking about earlier. It was a really safe place for people to go and kind of try out working in the community with folks from capabilities right there with them. And that really helped for a lot of people who were nervous. We also, all of our planning that we do with individuals starts right from the beginning, talking community-based goals. We don't start the conversation around anything facility-based. Every conversation is about what are we going to do that's going to eventually lead to being in the community. And some of the other things that we do is we mix volunteer experiences as well as paid experiences. And something we saw early on was that as more people started leaving during the day, especially with that ops program, as people were leaving during the day and going out and then coming back and talking about what they were doing and waving around their paycheck that they got, other people got motivated. Other individuals were getting motivated and going, wait a minute, I don't want to sit here all day. If she gets to go out, I want to go out. So peer pressure is actually quite helpful when it comes to some of this stuff. So we also are volunteering, and people have talked about volunteering, so I want to spend a lot of time on this. But our volunteer sites that we use are identified by the individuals that we serve. So they talk about what their goals are, where they'd like to work. And some examples, we go to a senior living facility and we serve ice cream. We actually go to a local elementary school where they serve popcorn to the kids at lunchtime once a week, and our clients are the ones working there serving the popcorn. We go to the library, we shelf books, we go to the animal shelter, we also go to the very large food bank and do sorting and packing for items at the food bank. But our staff, our pre-vocational staff, accompany the individuals when they go to these sites. And they, you know, in the case of the senior living facility, and actually the young woman pictured there, she started out going there serving ice cream as a volunteer experience, and then ended up getting a job working there in their food service area. So it was a nice way for her to try that out and get familiar, and also for the folks at that senior living facility to get to know her and see what she was capable of doing in a really non-threatening kind of way. The biggest thing that we've done is we've made the shift from shelter work to community work. And this was a big change for any organization doing the sheltered workshop. One of the things we had to do to say we're going to get away from doing sheltered work was figure out, okay, we have a lot of customers, business customers who send contract work, assembly work generally, to our facility. And we have individuals who have worked for these companies for many, many years in our facility. So we sat down and did some brainstorming and said, okay, who are the customers we've had long-term relationships with and consistent relationships with? And then who are the clients that have, you know, consistent experience? So we have clients who've worked for, one of the companies is a company in Elmira called Traeger Products. We have clients who've worked on the Traeger job for 5 years. So some things happened. So we identified the customers. And we identified three customers that had really good relationships with us, who really valued what it was that we were doing. And we had held meetings with them. And we talked to their management about what our expectations were and what our objective was and how we wanted to create a more integrated work environment. And then we worked with them in their facilities to find out, do they even have space within their manufacturing facility to have an area for our clients to come and work? We bring a supervisor in, just like we would if it was on our work floor. And then, you know, we did the other natural things, picking a start date. One of the things we had to do, though, was that for our customer, one of our customers, they didn't have the space during the normal, they run three shifts, but during their 7-to-3 shift, they didn't have a space for us. And when do people in sheltered workshops go to work? From 9 to 2 or 9 to 3? So the company, Traeger, said, you know, we don't have the space during those hours. Could you guys come in and do maybe like a 3:30 to 7 or a 4 to 8? And we said, wow, yeah, that's different. We can do that. And we talked to the clients, and the clients said, yeah, I actually don't really like getting up early in the morning, and we'd kind of like to come into work later. So we had to be really creative in that and work with, you know, and recognize the needs of that business to make sure that what we were doing for them was going to be helpful and not interfering. And then we just, you know, we started the implementation with the individuals. The individuals went from working in a sheltered workshop under a 14C special wage certificate, earning a piece rate. When we transition over to the community-based jobs, we start paying minimum wage. We, you know, 14C certificate technically would cover us at that business site, but we said, you know, that's not where we're headed. That's not our philosophy. If they're going to work in the community and be integrated in the community, we're going to pay them at the community wages. That was a risk. Our finance folks thought that was risky, that we could really, you know, could hurt us financially, and it actually worked out.
So what did we find?
We found the clients were a lot more productive when they were working in an integrated environment
with other
people who were working than they were working in a sheltered workshop with other people with disabilities. So some of the challenges. This might rub some people the wrong way, but I would say, and it's at the top because it is one of the number one challenges that we faced as an organization, trying to help people go into more community-based work, and that was the restrictions on residential service providers. A lot of folks, as you know, live in, you know, group homes, and we found that the residential staff really struggled with two things: transportation and schedule changes. So a lot of the jobs that folks are doing happen later in the day, happen after 4 o'clock maybe happen on a Saturday or a Sunday. And we have had a real struggle, and this is what I was kind of, when we talked earlier as we were planning for this about, was we have to do a better job training residential services around what employment looks like, because they struggle with the idea that someone, A, they want them gone during the day. Let's just be honest. They say, well, they can't be home from 9 to 2 and go to work from 4 to 8. We have dinner at 5. They have, you know, they have a dance that they want to go to. I mean, they really struggled with that. And they are probably one of the bigger barriers that we have, I think, as a system for folks who live, you know, in a certified setting. They struggle with that. They struggle with what people are going to do during the daytime, and they struggle with transporting around those different hours too. So we have to really work on that. Another big challenge was our internal agency staff. I would like to say that all of our staff fully embrace the idea that people in sheltered workshops could move into the community, but the reality is not everyone did. A lot of folks really struggled with that and thought, no, he can't go out in the community, he can't sit still. He can't sit there and do his work. He gets up 6 times between 10 and 10:30 to go to the bathroom. He's never going to go out in the community.
Well,
those staff
are no longer with us.
And that was and that was ultimately, you know, that was their choice to leave. They couldn't really embrace this idea. And
guess what?
The individuals proved them wrong.
The individual could not sit at his table and put his parts together for 3 hours nonstop and not have a
drink every 5 minutes, went out into the community and performed better than the Access VR person who was in short employment. And when I asked him, I said, now how come when you're here, you can't sit in your chair for more than 5 minutes, but you can go out and work?
Because
Dean, who's our production manager, Dean's not going to fire me. I can't lose my job here, but out there at CVS, I can lose that job. They'll fire me if I don't work the whole time. So that was interesting, and that really highlighted for us, like, this is what a lot of individuals think. Like, well, I'm here, and I'm socializing. It was hard. It was hard for our internal agency staff. The other things we had to battle with were the workplace cultures within these community-based businesses. And how did we tackle that? Is we did education with their management and staff about what it meant to work with somebody with a disability. A lot of people think of someone with a disability and have a very, very stigmatized image in their mind and are afraid
to work with somebody
with a disability. In fact, in one of the instances, the question that the staff, who thankfully were very open with me, said was, well, what if they have to go to the bathroom? And this was somebody who could go to the bathroom, was very independent. I said, yeah. They said, well, what if they have to go to the bathroom? I said, then show them where the bathroom is, and they can go to the bathroom. But that was another, I mean, that's another reality we're facing. We have to do some education of these community businesses about what disabilities really look like. And the last challenge was the families. The families have a few things. It's a lot of fear.
They're afraid for their sons or daughters to take a risk, to go out in the community. They want the safety and the protection of the agency. And they're also afraid of losing benefits. So we do a lot of benefits education with families on how you can work and still keep your benefits. And then to help alleviate the fear, we really had to do a lot to like show them that our staff are going to be with your son or daughter. We'll be there. We'll be supporting them. You know, there's lots of communication around that. So what are some of the successes of moving from a sheltered environment to community-based? Decreased behavior. I've already talked about that. Individuals who come into our facility and throw their work and refuse to work, go out in the community and are so much more successful because they're emulating the behavior that they see in that work environment. We also see increased productivity both outside in the community and on days when they're in the facility working. Their productivity is increased. I think it's really important to just note that if we rated our individual work, my work, your work, what we're doing, based on our productivity, I can almost guarantee nobody here at any of these sites across the state is productive 100% of their day. And we all take breaks, and we all stop and chat, and we talk about we talk about the tornado that happened last night. And so we're not productive 100% of the day, and I think that's important to remember when we're talking about the individuals and talking about them going to work, and we rate everything on productivity. God forbid if my boss rated my performance on my productivity. The other thing we saw was decreased overhead costs because we were doing more community-based work. We needed less space within our facility for the sheltered workshop. But not only that, the decreased overhead costs came to our community businesses who were spending money to transport materials to us, who had wear and tear on their trucks, who had to make sure they had a driver available to come pick up parts, drop off parts, those types of things. It was just a much more efficient operation if we were right there in their facility doing the work. If they needed a change, if they needed a special job done, they didn't have to call, try and get the production manager, organize it. They could just come down, talk to the supervisor, who's one of our employees, and say, hey, can you switch from this item to that item because we need to get this order out? And it really helped decrease a lot of those costs. It allows for a lot of flexibility in services. So when individuals are really motivated and want to go in the community, they can, and we work with them on that. And then if for some reason we had one woman who was hospitalized, and when she came back from being hospitalized, she needed to be in that facility-based program. And so she was able to do it. There's a lot of fluidity in how we do it. People come in and they go out, and we want to keep that as flexible as possible. Our opportunity to educate the community on what it is that we do as an organization, as we do as a field, and what disabilities and work look like has been a real highlight of this. And then finally, it's been talked about already today, is just the success of we're allowing individuals to take a risk and to try it out, and we're letting people, it sounds bad to say we're letting people fail, but if people fail, that's okay, and they can fail, and they can come back, and we'll try again. We've had people who've gone out and tried 6, 8, 10 jobs, and you know, for whatever reason, we just haven't found the right job match, but we don't stop working with them because of that. So that's everything I have.
Thank you. I just want to check to see, do we have Middletown on yet?
Yes, we're on.
Okay, so we are now being joined by Commissioner Burke, and I really want to thank you, Commissioner, because I know you're on the road and you took time out of your schedule to go to a VC site, and so I just want to hand things over to you quickly just to make a few remarks, and then we'll get back into the program.
Thanks so much, Salon, for letting me make a few remarks. I hate to interrupt these presentations. I got to see the end of People Inc., and I just got to see Capabilities. I was very impressed with both of them. I particularly like the fact that Capabilities, your candor in talking about some of the challenges that you've encountered, but then how you've overcome them and the successes that you've seen by being persistent and trying different opportunities with people. I've had the opportunity in my various travels around the state to see some of these really wonderful examples and seeing what is possible for people. And I really have been struck by the agencies who have taken the employment goal to heart and thought differently about how services could be delivered, and how they have seen the lives of individuals change as a result of the success. And a lot of times there may not be success the first time around, But when you finally do get to that point, it is really life-changing for the individuals, and it's incredibly inspiring. So I think you have a wonderful lineup today, Salon. I want to thank you and your staff for putting this together. I think it's really exciting that we have so many providers participating. I also want to thank the providers for all the innovative work that you're doing and how you're trying to work with us to help move the system forward even further. And also, I think there might be some parents on the VC today. Thank you for your openness to thinking differently about how services can be provided. Salon probably, or perhaps Jerry touched on some of the goals we have in our transformation agreement with CMS. And I think it's really exciting. I think when we first negotiated the agreement with CMS, it seemed a little daunting. It was a lot of changes around self-direction, housing, and employment. But now I'm very excited about what this means for people and how it can improve people's lives. And employment is a critical part of that agreement, and I think that we should all embrace it going forward. So thanks, Salon. I really don't want to take up any more time than that because you've got such great presenters on your agenda today.
Thank you.
Next presentation will be from Lexington Learning Center, Fulton ARC.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Wally Hart. I'm with Lexington, the Fulton County chapter of ARC. And I don't have a PowerPoint. I apologize. I got the blue screen of death yesterday on my computer, so we're still working on that. I'm going to talk to you about a couple of things that we've done recently. Within the last year, we've closed our sheltered workshop. It had been in place. Thank you. It was a big decision for us. It had been in place for 46 years. It was the backbone of our agency. It was a very, very difficult decision for us to make. I think the things that we're most scared about in listening, I don't want to repeat some of the successes and the things that have been talked about, but one of the things we were scared about is what would the individuals who were participating in the workshop fear? What would they be afraid of? What were their hopes and dreams and goals? And you know, as we sat down and the staff sat down and talked with them, found out that they weren't that afraid to make some change. We had some fun things. There were some people who had been in the shop for 42 years, so they said, "Can I retire?" There are other people in the agency who had retired, staff people that had retired, and so they said, "You know, can we retire?" Anyway, we were able to close the workshop and transition into a number of things. We sat down with every individual, about 80 people that were in the workshop, and said to them, what do you want to do? What are your goals? What are your dreams? What would you like to do? And as someone said earlier, there were a couple people said, I want a paycheck. There were a number of people that were really panicked about, well, I get this paycheck. What am I going to do? We were able to sit back and go, okay, the paycheck's $5.32 a week. We can find something. We can make that happen. You know, there were a couple of people that were making a couple of $100 a week. They really shouldn't have been in a sheltered workshop. But it was that safety net. Family didn't want them to go anyplace else because they were secure with where they were. We talked to them. We were able to separate some people out and say, okay, some of these people could go and retire. Some people could look at some new programs. We created a new program called the Good Neighbor Program, looking at what they were interested in doing. They said, we really like going out into the community and volunteering. So we looked at a good neighbor, we're calling the Good Neighbor Volunteer Program. That will also have some components of job skills and training and job shadowing so that they can explore those options for themselves if that's what they're interested in. We had had the same similar situation where we had a number of customers that we had been working with for all 46 years. So we've been doing the same jobs for some of those people. They knew when they were coming. Some of the jobs they didn't like, they knew to take sick days on those days so they didn't have to come in and do those things. So we really knew that we needed to make some changes to make people feel better about what they were doing and really provide the services that they wanted. The job shadowing program, what we're working on is we have a very active chamber of commerce in our community. We have a very active business community that is interested in education and jobs in the community. So we're partnering with the community college, the local BOCES, and the business community through the chamber to be part of what they're looking at in building an internship for young people that are coming out of school. And starting that at the ninth grade, The HFM BOCES, which is the Hamilton Fulton Montgomery BOCES, has just been approved by the State Education Department to create one of the first accredited internship programs in the state, so that students will actually be able to get credit and not, and it'll be credit that's worthy for the classes that they would be required for their credits for the diploma. We may not be part of that. We tend not to serve the number of students that we serve that are under 18. Most of the people that we support are over 18, but that transitional student we hope to work with. But we want to take advantage of the opportunity that the BOCES and the school districts and the business community are putting together for the job shadowing, so that we're going to integrate right into the community, and as people are, as businesses are saying, we'll be willing to have someone come into our business for job shadowing and an internship. We want to have the people that we support do the same exact thing. And so we're in the beginning talks of that. I've been part of that. As a disclaimer, I come from the chamber background. I was the president of a chamber for 10 years, so I have that, have those connections, and that's part of the benefit that I bring to working at the ARC. I've been part of the development of that program, and then just let them get to where they needed to be, and then started sliding in and saying, well, you know, we have a number of people that also could benefit from this. So we're just starting to have those conversations. The Good Neighbor Day program will be a traditional day program, but it will have some new attributes to it. The soft skills, going out into the community, having a sheltered workshop for 46 years, really limited the number of opportunities and the exposure people had to the community. So we need to provide some of those opportunities to go out and do some job shadowing. They will go out on a one-on-one basis with some staff, and will actually go and spend some significant time in a business to see whether they're interested. Is this, if you've never worked in food service, it seems glamorous until you actually have to do it. Never worked in, hospitality. Again, not everybody's cut out for hospitality. Not everybody's cut out for food service. Not everybody's cut out for healthcare. Not everybody's cut out for any job. So we want to give people a number of opportunities over a 10-month period to go and explore what's out there. We're also going to incorporate some volunteer opportunities by working with the Office for the Aging. Office for the Aging has been in our community, and we've been partners with them for many years because we run the Meals on Wheels program, and that's one of the big benefits that we have, is that that is housed in our facilities. We cook meals and serve and deliver 450 meals every day. Half of those meals are delivered by volunteers from our programs. So they go out every day. They get to meet people. And that's where they came to us and said, well, you know, I go every day and I meet Mrs. Jones or I meet Mr. Smith, and, you know, they're all alone. And is there something we could do? Could we do more? I'd like to go see them more often. You know, when we're there delivering a meal, we don't have time to stop and say, well, how are you? And, you know, we're just checking to see if there's, you know, they can come to the door and get their meal. They ask us, can you come in and put something in my basement? I can't go down in the basement. I can't get down in the basement. I'm afraid to go down the stairs. Can you take my dog? Can you put the dog on the leash and put it, you know, there's a chain out there. I'm just, you know, whatever, those kinds of things. So we had heard that those were the interests, the concerns that they were having. So we went and sat down with the Office of the Aging and said, what are your needs? What are you facing with the cuts that you've had in your programs? What are the seniors in our area, which is the majority of our population is a senior population. We have a large percentage of our population, over 50% of our population is seniors. So we know that they need services. So we've started to build a roster with them, things that we can build into a volunteer effort and things that we can build into a business effort, so that we could look at, well, is landscaping and you know, those kinds of services that people need, could that become a business for us? Could we find a model for that? So we're working with the OFA to create that opportunity. We did some renovations of our workshop. It's actually, so the part of the reason I was late was because every contractor is there. I've given them a deadline of June 19th because I'm holding an event there, a fundraiser, so I had to come up with a deadline. And they're all running around trying to change it, but the exciting thing is to see the people from the workshop people who had worked in the workshop walked through this space, which had been a workshop for 46 years, that's now being turned into classrooms, meeting rooms, training rooms, and some other, a gallery space for our creative arts expression program. So some really exciting things that we're doing there. And those are the opportunities that we're trying to expand upon, as well as some business opportunities. We've created a number of businesses. We have no one. We gave up our 14C certification. Somebody else said that they did that, and that was very scary for our financial people as well, but it's gone. Absolutely everyone is being paid a minimum wage or higher. We've created a number of jobs within the business, within our own agency, because we were paying outside businesses to do jobs. We had asked them to provide some employment. They said they really couldn't do that. I said, okay, you want to give us employment? We'll create our own business, and we'll do the job that you were doing. And so we're providing the employment for the people that were, you know, that really wanted and were able to, and were really looking to expand. So that's what we've done at Lexington. I'd be happy to share any other details if anybody has any questions. Thank you.
So we have another presentation before our break, Ontario ARC. And they're going to talk about also workshop closure, some of their efforts to get their staff, their board, you know, in support of the workshop closure, and then some of the innovative things they're doing around students moving into employment, a new exciting initiative related to Project Search and your college experience program. So you're going to talk about a lot.
Thanks so much. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Josh Elias. I am the Director of Employment Services at Ontario ARC, located in Canandaigua, New York. And what I'm going to walk you through, as Salon alluded to, is our workshop closure process, similar to what you just heard about. So just to kind of give you a little bit of background and about the workshop, it opened in 1970 and started out with 12 people. And roughly as we got into the mid-90s, towards the end of the 1990s, there was probably a little over 200 people that the workshop served. We had a capacity of 300 individuals that could be in there, but right, I want to say about 220, 225 is what we maxed out at. We served 70 local businesses within Ontario County at any given one time. And we had multiple business contracts. We had NYSED contracts, GW Lisk, it's a big manufacturer in Ontario County, Gould's Pumps, Cadbury Schweppes, Mott's. So, you know, we had a lot of good contracts with a lot of local employers, and it provided good work opportunities for the people in the workshop. So why'd we close it? Well, many reasons, as you'll see here. One of the biggest ones is that there was an operating deficit of $500,000. When that many individuals are working in the workshop, you know, they're each being paid to do their work. You have staffing, you have, you know, maintenance costs, you have the building costs. And so over the course of time, the losses just started to mount. So when it got to $500,000, they're taking a look at the budgets and said, really, we need to take a look at this, and is this something that we can sustain to continue to do? Sustaining work was becoming difficult. It was towards the end of, 2007, 2008. The deficit, the budget from the economy, very poor. Businesses were sending work overseas. Some of our manufacturers were saying, well, it's probably cheaper for us to send it over to China to do rather than to send it to your workshop. Work processes became automated. So it was just starting to be phased out altogether. There were no new referrals. Parents weren't sending referrals for their children to be enrolled into the workshop because it wasn't an integrated setting. They really wanted something different. They wanted something more. And so they just started to say, you know, we want some opportunities that are outside of the workshop and different work opportunities. They wanted community-based alternatives. They felt their children being isolated in the workshop. And so, you know, the agency had to take a look at, you know, what can we do to meet the demands of what the parents are looking for. So in 2009, May of 2009, our executive director and the management team went to our board of directors to discuss this proposition with them, let them know, you know, what's going on with the workshop, what some of the challenges were that the agency was facing, and what some of the alternatives would be should they approve the workshop being closed. So new service models were developed. That was one of the first things that they did, to take a look at. We closed the workshop. what are other areas that we can provide opportunities in. So from employment standpoint, supported employment, competitive-based employment, our enclaves, personal enrichment, what are things out in the community that we might be able to move some of the folks out of the workshop into doing?
Volunteerism.
I think that's a big theme throughout today, is that a lot of agencies are looking to volunteerism to get people out in the community and gain some work experience and community exposure. Seniors. We had individuals that were in the workshop for 30-plus years, and they were ready to stop working. So we didn't offer any programs for individuals that were ready for retirement. So, you know, what can we do to help them out? Originally, what the agency looked at was doing an on-site seniors program within the agency. But again, that wasn't being out in the community. That wasn't being integrated. So we looked to move our what's called our community centers out into the community into different locations. And then community learning centers. Some day-hab type programs are out in the community interacting with at the YWCA, YMCA, different churches, getting people out, getting them exposure. Oh, there you go. So parent meetings were held. They were set up 4 different meetings across the agency, and only 2 families attended. And I was doing some research into this because I've only been with the agency for a couple years, so the workshop closure process was all new to me. I was speaking to our executive director, Ann Sheets, and she said that. I'm like, well, how many 2 families? Weren't there more people that were concerned about what was going to happen if the workshop closed? And she said, honestly, no. There has always been good communication with the families whose children we support. And people were confident that whatever plan we came up with would be a good plan, would be successful. So there wasn't a lot of concern on families' behalf as to what we would do to replace the workshop. Transition plans were created. So over the course of the year, when the board was informed of the workshop closure to the time it actually closed, the plans were created, who's doing what? What bucket would they fall into? So is someone going to, you know, who are the individuals that would be best suited by the enclave? The community learning centers, the senior centers. Those are identified. And then in April 2010, the workshop closed. There are still some remnants of the workshop that are open. There's bottling contracts, shredding contracts, and a coin cleaning contract that we continue to participate in. That is through our day-hab. That's a paid work opportunity for folks. And basically what those opportunities are used for is assessment. So people make money completing those jobs within the day have on the pre-voc side. And then there's also our vocational job assessor comes in and uses those as an opportunity to find out what work skills people have. So what are some of the strategies that we're using to employ folks? I talked about our Pathways program. It's not a traditional day-hab program. It's what we call the blended program, in that it has not only a day-hab component but also a pre-vocational component. They offer volunteering opportunities, whether that's through Meals on Wheels, Sonnenberg Garden. They help do some landscaping there. We do some work at the Finger Lakes Racetrack with the retired horses going in and helping to take care of them. So there's the unpaid volunteer experiences, but there's also paid experiences as well, as I alluded to with the NYSED contracts. We have retail businesses in place where they make pet beds that are sold, pet treats that are sold. They're working on dog collars that are going to be sold. So they have an opportunity to gain experience in different areas and get paid for it at the same time. Our enclaves, we have 3 permanent enclaves. And we also have what we call 3 temporary enclaves. We call it the SWAT team. When they have workforce, we get a crew together, they go in, they do the work, and when it's completed, they pull out. What we're doing with our enclaves is making sure that they're all integrated and competitive, because that's the big push. And I want to say a majority of the folks that work in our enclaves are making minimum wage. We do have some folks who aren't, because there are some individuals, given what their challenges are, that just aren't going to be able to hit that, but we're doing whatever we can to work with them to get them as close to minimum wage as possible. ESEMP and ETP, I don't really have to go into those. I think everyone knows about those programs. We've had a lot of luck. We have 6 ESEMP slots that we work with. We have multiple slots within ETP. Our college experience program, we have 2 of these programs. One is offered at Hobart and William Smith campus, the other at Finger Lakes Community College. It offers individuals the college experience, also teaches them life skills. There's employability skills training that's incorporated into that. And then on the pre-voc side, they participate in unpaid internships. They do 4 rotations throughout the year. They work 2 days a week for 2 hours at 4 different sites. They do get a gift card, so although they're not completely unpaid, it does provide them some incentive to get the work training and the work experience. And we've tied in the college experience program with the ETP program because what we found is once they're done with the program, it's anywhere from 3 to 5 years, the college experience program, we look to employ the individuals. Some of the employers know who the person is based on the short amount of time they spent with the business. So they're comfortable with them, but not completely comfortable. So we offer the ETP program as a bridge to help move them into employment. And out of the 9 people that have graduated so far, 8 of those have found employment and are currently still employed through the ETP program. And then we have 4 other graduates that are going to be graduating. Actually, they just did graduate. And they all lined up with jobs through ETP. So we've had a lot of success with that, and it's been really a good thing for those people in the college experience. Then there was a Project Surge program, which we implemented in November of last year. I'm not sure how many people are familiar with Project Surge. Our program is a little more non-traditional in that we aren't tied with a school district or AccessVR for funding and teaching. So it's not a student-to-work transition program. We call it our adult-to-our work transition program for adults. Young adults, ages 21 to 30. We provide the job coaching, and that is through units that were left on the table when we closed the workshop. So, well, workshop's no longer in place, but we still have some remnants of that involved with the funding that helps fund our job coach and our instructor through the program. It's been very successful. We've been able to be a little bit smaller than what a traditional program would have, be anywhere from 10 to 12. We started out with 5, worked our way down to 4. Unfortunately, someone had to disenroll from the program, but it's been very successful. We partnered with Finger Lakes Health as our business partner. We've grown our relationship with them a great deal, and so we have our 4 folks who will be ending the program at the end of July, and 2 of those individuals have very strong prospects of being employed at Geneva General Hospital once that program is through. So just an example of one of the stories of one of the individuals who's kind of gone through the continuum of services through employment services. Tim started in the workshop in 1998. He came out of school, went into the workshop, was there for about 2 years. It was determined at that point through the different assessments he'd go through every 6 months that he was ready to move to the next level. So he came into supported employment. He wanted a job out in the community. We helped him find that at Thompson Hospital. As he got into it after 3-4 months, it was kind of obvious that he wasn't quite ready for that step yet. So he went into an enclave where he worked for several years and said, listen, I want to give it another shot. So we looked to the ETP program to make this happen. We got him involved in the Canandaigua VA Medical Center, and then after 18 months, they hired him onto this payroll, which was absolutely a wonderful thing. He went from making $7.50 an hour, I think he makes over $13 an hour now, with federal benefits. The Canandaigua VA Medical Center has been a big partner with us. We've had 3 or 4 people via the ETP program that we have gone through there, and it's such a great opportunity for them because if you look at traditional jobs, I mean, most of our folks are going to come in, they're looking at the minimum wage range. These individuals are coming in starting out at over $12 an hour, and then within a 3-year period with their pay increases, they're going to be upwards of $15 an hour. It's a long way to help them get off some of the services there, the SSI, anything through the Department of Social Services. So it's really been a win-win for everyone, and we continue to use that model to move people through. That's it.
Thank you, Josh. Okay, so we are going to take a quick break. Let's take a 5-minute break and then come back for Q&A. So a 5-minute break and then we'll come back for Q&A. And I'm sure there's going to be lots of great questions.